Great, thank you very much. It is an absolute honor to be here, and both of us are really happy to be here. So what we're going to do is we're going to rotate back and forth in terms of talking about the program Law Enforcement Assisted Diversion, which both of us were involved in implementing in Seattle back in 2011. So we'll just rotate as we go through. So I'm going to start out by giving you a little bit of background about why this program came about. And I'll just start with just giving you a brief description of the city of Seattle. So the city of Seattle is on the northwest part of the United States. It's a port city of about 650,000 people. It's highly dependent upon, was originally highly dependent on maritime trade. We still are very highly trade dependent. Boeing, Microsoft, Amazon are all based there. So the city is going through a lot of gentrification. It's a young city. And it is has a high degree, large number of immigrants, both internally from within the United States and increasingly from Asia and East Africa. So that's sort of the basic demographics of the population. Seattle also has a reputation for having a very large number of homeless individuals and has had a reputation for having drug and alcohol problems going back to the 1950s and 1960s. So this is just something that has been entrenched in sort of the city culture for a very long period of time. In the 1990s, Seattle was the first or second highest city in the United States for numbers of individuals testing positive for opiates when they were admitted into jail. So in a city of about 650,000 people, there are an estimated 15 to 20,000 injection drug users and a very large number of non-injecting drug users. We don't really have very good estimates of what that population is, but it's significantly larger than the population of folks who are injecting drug users. In the mid to 1980s, Washington State, like much of the United States and other parts of the world, really ramped up the war on drugs. And so we went to a type of sentencing. I won't bore you with all the legal intricacies of it, but basically it was a form of mandatory minimum sentencing where if you were convicted of a drug crime, you were gonna receive a minimum sentence. And each time you got a new conviction, the length of your sentence would go up. So you would start out with a minimum conviction time of 1 year. And by the late 1980s, we were in fact sending people to the state penitentiary for 10 years for possession of $20 worth of drugs. And it got to the point that by 2008, 25-26% of all inmates inside the Washington State prison system were in there for drug charges alone, no other charge at all. So this was the situation that we were confronted with in both locally in Seattle and throughout Washington State. The other thing that started happening was around 2008 and 2009 in Seattle, there was an increasing amount of frustration all across the board about the issue of outdoor open air drug markets, outdoor drug sales, outdoor drug consumption. And what we were facing at that point was a situation where nobody was happy. Residents and business owners were complaining and putting a lot of pressure on the police department and on prosecutors to do something about it. The police and prosecutors were responding by, how much more can we possibly do? We are arresting hundreds and hundreds of individuals and sending them to prison for long jail sentences, and we're not achieving any results. Civil rights advocates were engaging in ongoing litigation over the issue of drug arrests, and in particular racial disparity that was occurring in the drug arrest patterns. The police were incredibly frustrated by this situation. So by 2009, it became absolutely clear that the status quo was not working for anybody. And it was not working for very different reasons. But everyone was agreeing that the current situation was not tenable. And so this set the stage for people who normally, and we joke about this in Seattle, the only time we ever used to talk to each other was when we were before a judge and we had to. But what started happening was people that really never engaged in dialogue agreed to leave our differences aside at the door and to sit down and talk to each other about what is it that we can all do that we can agree on that will make this situation better. And this actually grew out of a question by Captain Nollet's former than boss, a very visionary captain within the Seattle Police Department, who at one point said, now, assuming that we all agree that the situation is not working, and assuming that your criticisms of the police department are accurate, what would you have us do as a department that is different from what we're doing now that would still address the issue of outdoor drug sales and outdoor drug consumption? And that was really the genesis for law enforcement assisted diversion. So LEAD was first piloted in Seattle back in October of 2011. We've been operating for 4.5 years, and it is being adopted by numerous cities around the United States and getting interest internationally as well.
Who effed the meeting?
There you go. I meant that.
So I am Deanna, and I am currently a captain with the Seattle Police Department. I am a 20-year police veteran. I know some of you, especially the law enforcement men in the room, probably find that hard to believe, but I've lasted 20 years in law enforcement. I am an FBI graduate as well, as a local law enforcement, and also a graduate of the Senior Management Institute for Policing at Harvard University. So when I first got approached by my then visionary boss, I was a mere sergeant, which is kind of the first step up from patrol officer. And you're bright and you're shiny and you're new. And he said, Deanna, you're going places in this department, which is usually a warning sign in law enforcement that you're going to be told to do something you really don't want to do. And he said, we're going to do this new program to deal with low-level drug offenses. And I'm going to want you to partner with the Defenders Association, the Prosecutor's Office, the American Civil Liberties Union, service providers, and low-level drug crime people. To which I'm thinking, could I do anything else? Could I be on a traffic post, ceremonial guard, maybe in front of a large castle-like building? Anything but this. But he said, listen, what we're doing isn't working, and it sounds very much from what you guys were talking about this morning, it's not working for the exact same reasons that what you're doing here isn't working, and that's nobody's needs are being met. An incredible amount of resources are being wasted, and we're enforcing the wrong laws on the wrong people for the wrong reasons and getting bad outcomes. And yet, much like Seattle was back in 2010, we continue to do the same things over and over and over, expecting different outcomes. And that, as people have famously put, is actually the definition of insanity. So Seattle said, okay, let's set aside all of these differences and let's see what we can come up with. And I'm gonna read this. I'm gonna give in and put reading glasses on. It's kind of an old lady thing that just hit me, but I need them in order to make sure I get this right. The idea was a partnership between law enforcement, prosecutors, defenders, service providers, and elected and community leaders to address low-level crimes and reduce unnecessary and racially disparate criminal justice involvement with the goal to improve community health and safety. And it's a very lofty ideal that includes all of the people that are in this room and all of the agencies and disciplines that they represent. And yet it's a very simple program. Once we tell you about it, you're probably going to be thinking, why you guys aren't that smart? Because that's pretty simple. But that's actually kind of the genius of the program, is that we didn't wait until we got massive legislative change. We didn't wait until we could get every other country in the world to agree on it. We decided, as I said, to make a system that sucked a little less for some of the people. So we're going to kind of go through the basics of what's different about the LEAD program and how it was kind of a genius solution at the time to kind of address some of the disparities that existed.
Okay, this is sort of setting the stage for it. So what happened was, as Deanna said, we all agreed to start talking about it, and we started a working group, which had Captain Brown from the Seattle Police Department, it had someone from the prosecutor's office, it had myself and my boss, and someone from the American Civil Liberties Union, and we just started a really concrete discussion about what it is that we could do to take what is almost universally a bad outcome right now, getting arrested for drug possession or sales, and possibly change it into something that could be a positive outcome for the individual that's encountering law enforcement, and thereby change the dynamic of the interaction between street-level drug users and law enforcement. And that was really consciously what we were talking about doing. The key thing to remember here is that this is a collaborative effort among diverse parties, all of whom have agreed to work together on a few concrete details. So the police department, the prosecutor's office, and then special teams of case managers who are not like normal case managers. This is like very much guerrilla case management. It is street-based rather than office-based. And so people go out on the streets and work with individuals like underneath freeways, in tent encampments, wherever it is folks are at. And we all meet regularly. Twice a month we have meetings where police officers, case managers, and prosecutors all sit in the same room and talk to each other. And so sort of the consensus has been that everyone has agreed that policing is not the most effective way of dealing with low-level crimes such as drug possession, drug sales, or street-based sex work, prostitution. That a public health approach is a much, much better way of doing it, but that the police are uniquely situated to be able to offer referral into that system because they are the ones that are out on the streets 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and that know all of the individuals that otherwise would be sent into the criminal justice system.
So my initial role was actually to go within the department and kind of sell this idea, and then to go out into the community and see if we could get the community to support the department in doing it. And the first initial challenge is that when you're trained to be a police officer in the United States, you're trained how to shoot, you're trained how to drive fast, how to fight, how to handcuff, how to write reports, how to testify in court. You are not one taught how to talk to. And more importantly, you're not taught anything about drug addiction, recovery, or any of the related problems that people that are drug users have, kind of navigating the system. So for example, none of my officers had any idea that a drug conviction barred you from public housing and from housing assistance in the city of Seattle. It barred you from job training. It barred you from all sorts of benefits that you would otherwise be entitled to, which further marginalized people that were already criminalized by the system and made it likely that they would continue to engage in not just more criminality, but increasing criminality as they got pushed farther and farther out. So the first thing was to actually start talking to our officers about what it is to be addicted to drugs, what recovery looks like, and some of the barriers that our society puts on people that use drugs. Then we had to convince them that this isn't depolicing. It's not us abandoning our role as community caretakers and as guardians. It's actually better policing. And it's a return to kind of the ideals that Peel had about what it is to police. And it's an act that you engage in on behalf of the community with the community's cooperation to provide for increased public safety. So those were some of the really important kind of philosophical conversations that we had to have within the department to convince officers that if I arrest you for drug possession and I don't put you in jail, that I can still be doing good police work, in fact, maybe even better police work than I was doing before, and that the outcomes could potentially be better, not just for you, the individual, but for the community as a whole. So I basically had to go out and talk to the department, talk to the officers, and kind of get some buy-in that we're going to try to do something different. Not on the front end. We're still going to be doing undercover operations. We're still going to be doing narcotics investigations and narcotics enforcement. But that we're going to try something else, working with our prior adversaries to see if we couldn't get better outcomes for the people we were arresting. Then we had to go into the communities where we were going to pilot this program and basically explain the same thing to them, that this is not allowing people to get away with breaking the law. It isn't enabling people to do illegal things, you know, and have no consequences. That it actually was going to be better policing that led to better accountability and better communities. So we went out and we met with the officers, we trained the officers, we met with the communities, and we kind of got everybody to buy in to the idea of us trying it on an experimental basis in one particularly bad neighborhood that was basically an open-air drug market. And we got them to buy in because what we were doing didn't work for anybody. And I think everybody was desperate to say, okay, we might think it's a crazy idea, but we're willing to try anything at this point because what we're doing isn't helping. So in its simplest form, what LEAD is the officers would, the theory behind it, the officers would go out, they would do their narcotics enforcement, they would make arrests. They would look at the suspect's criminal history to ensure that they didn't have violent history in their past. So no murder convictions, arson, rape, robbery. So we weren't looking at violent offenders. We were basically looking at low-level drug offenses and non-violent offenders. And we specifically didn't rule out people that were doing subsistence dealing. I know that a lot of programs say, you know, there's a clear line between you possess drugs for your own use or you possess drugs to sell, and there's a big difference. But what we were seeing is there really wasn't a big difference. There were a lot of people that were low-level drug users that were doing low-level dealing just to subsist, to keep drugs on them and to keep food on the table for their families. So we actually did a distinction by weight, and at the time it was only 3 grams of possession. It's now gone up to 7. It's kind of evolved up to 7. But even when we did 3, I mean, there was pushback on that because as Captain Brown famously said to Chris, that's a lot of dope, Chris. But the theory is you're in possession of 3 grams or less at the inception. You don't have a violent crime history. Then the officer has an opportunity to assess whether or not you would be amenable to treatment. So basically, we would say to people, I can book you into the King County Jail like I always do, or would you like to meet with a caseworker? And if the person said, yeah, I think I'd like to, they were immediately hooked up with a case manager. And it's a lot like from what I've been hearing from Donna, it's a lot of what the street lawyers do, where you're meeting people where they are to provide for their immediate needs. One of the other things about the program that was unique and that was a tough sell both in the department and the community is we don't require that people go into treatment. The client, who I would refer to as a suspect, until they go into LEAD, then they're the client. The client actually identifies their own goals. And for a lot of them, it's simple as housing, stable housing. For some, it's reunification with families. They identify their goals. Treatment does not have to be one of those goals. Although in most of the cases, interestingly enough, at some point in the process, it does become that. Once they are referred, the only requirement is they complete an intake with that counselor within 30 days. So they have to do a rather lengthy interview with the counselor within 30 days. If they achieve that, the law enforcement part of that is done. That case that they were arrested on is held by the prosecutor. It goes away. That criminal case does not exist. They does not get out of jail free card. If they break the law, even while they're in LEAD, they can be arrested, they can be booked, they can be charged. But that charge on which they're deferred disappears, which means there's no process through the criminal justice system, there's no money spent dragging people through trials and through court, there's no judges involved, and there's no criminal record that attaches for that case. Then the magic is that then we have the regular meetings where we basically check on clients and how they're doing, and it's all of the parties to the LEAD that get together and talk about clients. And it's funny because clients actually don't like that because a lot of drug users can tell their caseworkers how great they're doing, but it's hard to get away with that when the officer that just saw you at 3 a.m. at the same corner that you were arrested on is there to say, actually not doing so well, I just saw him at 3 a.m. So there really was some increased accountability for the people that were there. So we have all of the meetings, we follow the progress, we try to watch how the clients are progressing towards whatever their goals are. And it's been a really interesting experiment in that we find that a lot of the people that we're dealing with were kind of the most chronic problems for the law enforcement officers. They were the ones that were getting arrested multiple times. They were cycling through the system, and yet their behavior never changed. We got officers actually engaged to the point where they were advocating with caseworkers, you know, you really need to work harder to get this guy into treatment. You know, I really think he's going to do well. Or, listen, I know that he's got another case from before this one, and he's got a court trial coming up, but I really don't want it to mess with his housing placement. So how do we coordinate him making it to court and him not losing his housing placement? So the LEAD program was transformational, not just in how the street officers were interacting with people that were using drugs or that were arrested for drug crimes, And it was transformational in the relationships between the different components of the system that were completely fragmented and not communicating with one another. But it was transformative in that you got a better understanding on all the parties' parts about what the roles were, what the limitations were, and what the challenges were to the different parts of the system. And we had some very creative problem solving. So if I have time, I know you're the time person, but I'm going to just tell one quick story. So a lot of our people were homeless and had housing issues, and they were eligible for veterans benefits, yet they had never figured out ways to navigate the system. In the city of Seattle, in order to go into the Veterans Administration, you need an ID card. If you don't need an ID card, you can't get in. But the way that you get an ID card is you go into the Veterans Administration and you ask them to give you an ID card. So we literally had clients that could be getting healthcare benefits and housing benefits, not getting them simply because they didn't have an ID card. So this came up at one of our operational group meetings, and one of our patrol officers said, I'll go print out a booking photo with all of his ID from the jail, and I'll give it to him, and then I'll have an ID card. Well, we had never known that was a barrier for people until we sat at this table and had that conversation. And what a simple, cost-free solution to help people get the benefits they were entitled to. But nobody had ever managed to have the conversation between the different parts. So it's kind of simple. The genius is that it's simple, or as we like to say, if it's simple enough, it's cop-proof. That's kind of the genius. So a couple of other key points is that, again, treatment is not required, although most of the people do eventually come to it. And it's a collaborative effort between all of the parties to try to get better outcomes for the individual clients and kind of for the system as a whole. And Chris is going to talk a little bit about the outcomes.
I am. But first I want to follow up just real quickly on a couple of things that Deanna mentioned. Just to clarify, so she said the eligibility criteria when we started was 3 grams, possession or sales, and I just want to make sure it's abundantly clear we're not talking marijuana here, right?
That's legal.
Not to run it. Specifically are targeting heroin, cocaine, and methamphetamine. That was the population that the Seattle Police Department is arresting 3,000 or more a year.
3,300.
So that's just something to clarify. So now it's 7 grams, which if 3 grams was a lot of dope, 7 grams is really a lot of dope. Even I'll admit that. So I just wanted to point that out.
Can I jump back in? Because I just realized I forgot social. So another really important thing that happened when we started the program was we had the arrest diversion program, which was driven by the police, which by the way, okay, especially for the legislature, only branch of government that works 7 days a week, 365 days a year, is the police department. That's why we were in charge of the street level. This is not that you legislators don't work hard, I'm just saying it doesn't approach that level. So one of the things that the officers came to us with was, you know, if I have all this street knowledge, I have 20 years of street experience, I know that Nana really needs help. I know that she really needs entrance into this system. Why do I have to wait for her to commit a crime? So the officers actually came up with, we need another avenue that we need to be able to refer people in without an arrest. And so now there's different ways in the lead. It can be an arrest diversion, but it can also be a social contact where an officer just is willing to come forward and say,
the system repeatedly. Sometimes the only place they had received their health care in 10 or 15 years was while they were in jail. So it's a really marginalized population that's really sort of out there and can be quite expensive to handle through alternative systems. Yet once they get into something like LEAD, it ends up costing significantly less.
And one of the genius parts of LEAD, other than being simple and cop-proof, which we definitely require on the law enforcement side of things, is that no one owns the program. It's not a police program, it's not a court program, it's not a defender program. It is a voluntary agreement of all of those entities to work together. And the fact that it's voluntarily means that everybody has to work to make sure that everyone's needs are being met. So I can't have my needs as a police commander met at the expense of the Defenders Association's needs to advocate for their clients. So there's a cooperative effort to make sure everybody's getting their needs met. There's also political cover that there's no one person coming up with this crazy idea and everybody's throwing rocks and taking pot shots at it. It's a unified approach to tell people, hey, it's something completely different that we're going to try collaboratively. And the idea is that since nobody owns it, nobody can really kill it either. So we've had three different police chiefs, and they've all had to kind of go along with this lead thing because it was so already accepted and was so already entrenched in all the other parts of the criminal justice system. So my advice to you is if you're going to make a change, it's the type of change you can make now. Because it's basically a procedural change. It's not a change in laws or legislations or certainly international treaties or agreements. It's something simple that at the heart of it takes you right back to what the fundamentals of good policing and good caretaking of community are all about. And it can survive leadership changes, both politically and in the separate entities that are trying to serve.
In addition to three different chiefs, we were on our second mayor and we had a complete transformation in our city council. And so one of our strategies in terms of working with the community with LEAD is whenever we have like elections at the city level, we go and meet with each of the candidates ahead of time and get a commitment from them in writing that they will support LEAD if they're elected. So from our point of view, it really doesn't matter who gets elected. We may think it matters for other reasons, but in terms of LEAD, it doesn't matter, and we've been very, very successful with that for the last 4.5 years, where in every single election, it would not have mattered who got elected. The level of support would be different, maybe. So just a couple of quick challenges, and then a summary, and then we're done here. So some of the barriers that we have faced in making LEAD really work, and this may be more a Seattle context than other places, but lack of housing. So a huge number of our individuals, over 80%, are homeless at the time of their diversion. So finding housing has been a critical issue for us and has been something that's very, very difficult. We're seeing differences in parts of the United States. Some parts do not have housing as that big an issue. Others are pretty similar to us. Wait lists for treatment. We do not have treatment on demand. And so getting people into treatment when they make the decision that they want it is something that has been problematic for us. And then changing outsider attitudes. And so I've been fond of saying for several years now that a lot of people are moving to addiction as a disease model. And people talk about addiction as a brain disease. And one of the things that I've been struck by in that process is that if addiction really is a disease, it's the only disease that I know of where we require the patient to give up their symptoms before we treat them for the problem. And so trying to get people out of that box has been something that's really, really critical for us. So as we both said, we're 4 years into this. We are still learning lessons as we go along. In Seattle, as Deanna mentioned before, we started really small with a limited number of squads at the police department in one neighborhood. We've now expanded it to multiple neighborhoods. We're going into new neighborhoods this year. We're working with a lot of new squads. We're also working with many, many jurisdictions around the states. There's about 28, 29 other cities that are looking to implement it. Two others already have, so it's definitely a work in progress, but it's something that's happening. Do you want to say anything?
Okay.